Welcome to the broadcast. Tonight, New York Governor George Pataki.
I have no doubt, literally no doubt, that when this is completed and the entire process, all of the reconstruction, including office space the size of downtown Baltimore, should be done by 2011 or 2012. And it's not just going to be done. It's going to be done in a way that speaks to the ages about how we did it right at ground zero.
Jill Abramson of the New York Times.
What we're doing Monday is looking at the toll of the 5 years, how people have coped with their loss. Its focus is really, these are true portraits of grief because they're about the family members of the people lost and how they've adjusted. Some of the portraits are full of resiliency, and some of them are very, very sad. Some of them are, you know, horrible, wrenching stories of, you know, when bad things continue to happen to good people, where the loss of 9/11 has been followed by illness and whatnot. And we have about,
which is an emerging story.
We're going to present to our readers, beginning on page one, about 30 of these 5 year later portraits.
And a preview of this weekend's U.S. Open Finals with Jim Courier.
I think James was very close last night. He had some opportunities that he let slip by, but he was very much in the match because he waited for the right opportunity to strike without giving away unforced errors.
Did he come 1 point to tying it at 2-2?
He had set points in the first set. He had some other set points later, and he just didn't get returns in the court. He got a little tight. And Federer got tight at the end of the match as well, which is interesting. I think that has to give Roddick, you know, a little bit of an eye-opener, that maybe if I can push this close, I'll get the crowd behind me, Roger may get tight, and I may have my chance.
Pataki, Abramson, and Courier coming up.
Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
For every drop of yourself you give, get every drop back. We offer over 80 ways to hydrate, energize, nourish, relax, or enjoy every drop of life.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by JP Morgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. Studios in New York City. This is Charlie Rose.
Governor George Pataki is here. He's been the governor of New York since 1995. Currently, he is the longest serving U.S. governor. He's also mentioned as a contender for the 2008 Republican presidential nomination. On this fifth anniversary of 9/11, he is especially important as one of those responsible for overseeing the redevelopment of the World Trade Center. Thursday, he and others attended the unveiling of the designs for the office towers at the site. I am pleased to have him back at this table. Welcome.
Thank you, Charlie. Good being back with you again.
Tell me what, first of all, this, how did we change because of 9/11?
Well, I think we, first of all, after the initial attacks, we changed in a profound way in that we had a sense of unity that I'd never seen in my lifetime. There were no New Yorkers or Californians, Christian or Jew, white or black. The sense of unity that came out of those horrible attacks, I think, changed us dramatically for the better.
There was solidarity like we'd never seen.
There was patriotism. There was a common belief that our freedom had been attacked and we all had to stand together as Americans to defend it. And I think that was the most important from the standpoint of the human spirit that came out of that. At the same time, we also, I think, appreciated life a little bit more, yeah. Understood that on a beautiful day when we were at peace, out of the blue, horrible tragedy could strike, and appreciate our families and our friends a little bit more. And then finally, I think the entire country was inspired by the firefighters, the police officers, the EMTs, the people who I had worked with for a decade and had enormous respect for, but sometimes you take for granted those who put a uniform on and pledge to risk their lives to protect our lives. And I don't think today, 5 years later, people forget that those are true heroes.
Have Has that solidarity, though, been lost,
Charlie,
in over 5 years?
Charlie, I'm concerned about that. That sense of common purpose was so important. You know, we face enormous challenges, and the American people know that, whether it's overdependence on foreign oil. We are in a war against those who want to attack us again. And yet in Washington, it seems too often there's just the desire to gain partisan advantage and some political benefit as opposed to working together to solve the problems that we face. And that unity is what got us through after September 11th. And I'd love to see the American spirit recapture some of that so that we could have a common goal as we attack the problems our country faces.
Have those of you in government, federal and state and local, ask Americans, because we are at war, to do enough, to sacrifice enough? Should we have asked more of us to make and join in those who had to go and serve in making a sacrifice to support the effort?
Well, I think the American people understand we are in a war, and the American people are doing and prepared to do whatever it takes to defend our freedom. You know, now that you can end up at the airport and you have an hour and a half line, and nobody wants that, but people understand that there's a new reality after September 11th. And if there's one thing I wish we did do more of, it's show our respect and honor to those who put on the uniform of our country now and are risking their lives overseas to defend our freedom. And we're in a war, and we can never forget the fact that for all the great laws we pass and the pride we have and what we might do in government, unless we have people willing to put their lives on the line to defend our freedom, we're not going to continue to live in the greatest country the world has ever seen. So I don't know that it demands more direct sacrifice. It demands understanding. It demands trying to put aside that political gain to find common purpose. And if we do that, I'm confident that whatever challenges we face, we can overcome.
You're a former lawyer. You were at Yale Law School Law Review, as I remember. You studied constitutional law. Have we come close to some erosion of due process because we're engaged in this battle?
Charlie, Columbia Law.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Forgive
sorry.
Me, but I have to be loyal. Yale undergraduate,
right.
Columbia
Yale
Law.
Undergrad, right.
But no, I don't think so. I think the American people understand, and law provides that when you have those who have attacked us and want to attack us again, that you have to be able to take extraordinary action. And I think the Patriot Act is one of the reasons why 5 years later, thank God, we have not been attacked again. I think the idea that the federal government, with appropriate limitations, can monitor a call from overseas when there's a suspected that one of the people to the conversation is engaging or planning to engage in terrorist activity, I think those are all reasonable safeguards. And we have to understand that we're in extraordinary times. We have to preserve our freedoms. We have to preserve the constitutional rule of law. I mean, I think that's the essence of America, is that we are a nation that is governed not just by our civilized behavior, but the rule of law. And I think we haven't crossed those lines.
Where were you on that day?
I was here in New York, and normally I would be in Albany or someplace other than the state, and I'll never forget. My daughter was here at the Bloomberg Studios.
It was a different building.
Different
but it was
building at Bloomberg.
And one block
called,
away.
Called up and said, "Dad, turn on the TV. A plane hit the towers." And I turned it on, and like everybody else, I was wondering, how could this be? It was a beautiful day. And then I saw the second plane hit, and right away, I knew we were under attack and that we had to take action. And everybody from the local officials to the state officials to the federal officials immediately went into emergency response mode and responded with incredible courage.
When you look, you and I together attended a ceremony, you participated, and I interviewed some of the architects responsible yesterday for the unveiling of buildings 2, 3, and 4. This was the unveiling of drawings for the buildings, which will be completed. Many New Yorkers have wondered why it took so long. Do you have an answer for that?
Sure. Charlie, first of all, we didn't want to build for today and rush it. We wanted to make sure we built for tomorrow, for the next decade, for the next generation. And at the end, when people look back, we want them to say they did it right. So the first part was not to develop a building or take particular action, but was to have a strategic master site plan for all of what had been ground zero. And we had the broadest public process ever. We had 10 million hits on the internet when the different master site plans were under discussion before the Libeskind brilliant concept was picked. And then we had to turn that concept into architectural drawings, into engineering drawings, into construction documents. And from the beginning, the belief was always that within the actual bathtub, the area where the towers stood, we were going to have three structures: the memorial, the Calatrava Transportation Center, which will be incredibly inspiring, and the Freedom Tower. None of those we anticipated would be done before 2009. So I just am very proud of where we are, and more proud of what people are going to think when they come back 10 years from now and take a look and see what has happened at that sacred site.
What do you think they will think?
I think they'll think they did it right. The centerpiece is going to be the memorial, and it has to be, because we want to tell the story of September 11th. We want to tell the story of those who died, but we also want to tell the story of the courage and the strength with which New York responded. And at that memorial, which will be almost half the site, where the towers stood, there are going to be voids. And those voids will have waterfalls dropping into reflecting pools so that future generations will be able to appreciate the magnitude of the scale of the loss of September 11th. But then around those voids, we're going to have the name of every individual. And below in the Memorial Museum, we're going to tell their stories so we don't forget the individuals and their stories as well.
But with respect, it has been a protracted process.
Sure it has been.
To get here.
Sure it has. This is probably the most important site and probably the most difficult site to move forward with in a consensual manner, but that's what I've always wanted to do, and that's what we are doing. It's not just something where we're going to have this moving memorial, and we're going to have, as you mentioned, those magnificent new office towers rising to what will be the culmination, the Freedom Tower, 1,776 feet tall. We have to do it respectfully. There are subway lines we had to put in underneath. There are Port Authority trains coming from New Jersey we had to put in underneath. And, you know, I'm going to be Governor Charlie another maybe 3.5 months. I would have loved to stand there and cut the ribbon and say we are opening up the Freedom Tower, the tallest building ever built in America.
And we have the finest museum
in
memory
of great
people who died.
But that's not what it's about. It's not about a politician cutting a ribbon. It's about 10 years from now.
But it is about people. It is about people working together and politicians using their influence to encourage people to do the right thing.
That's correct. And we've done the right thing. And I have no doubt, literally no doubt, that when this is completed and the entire process, all of the reconstruction, including office space the size of downtown Baltimore, should be done by 2011 or 2012. And it's not just going to be done. It's going to be done in a way that speaks to the ages about how we did it right at Ground Zero.
Take a look at this. This is a artificial reality look at how this new office towers and how with 17, with Freedom Tower and the new office buildings, the skyline of New York will look like when all of this is completed. These are the plans that were unveiled yesterday. There is also this question that is forever with us now after 9/11. Mm-hmm. Are we safer? Are we safe? Could it happen again? What are we doing in terms of people in power to make sure that we're doing everything we can?
Charlie, I think we are safer. First of all, we're aware. On the morning of September 11th, this was something that no one, I think, anticipated, that this magnitude of attacks would have occurred, and not just in New York, but in Shanksville with the plane and in Washington with the Pentagon. I don't think anybody would have anticipated that. So we are aware now. And certainly, if some may have forgotten just a few weeks ago what happened in London, again raises people's awareness. And not only are we aware of the threats, we're acting to deal with them. I've never seen the level of coordination and cooperation between law enforcement, the city, which has the finest police department in the world. I know we have the finest Homeland Security office in the state of any state in America, and we are getting the information and the cooperation from the federal government. We are being aggressive as a nation in trying to deny those who would attack us again safe sanctuaries where they could plan or plot or recruit or train to go forward with more attacks. But I don't think anyone can look at you and honestly say that we're totally safe and that this can't happen again. We have to do more. We have to continue to be vigilant. And ultimately, what we have to do is not just defeat those who would engage in terrorism today, but take away the climate that that encourages those who have no sense of optimism about their future to detest the freedoms that we cherish so dearly.
As you know, there's been tension between New York and Washington about funds from Homeland Security. Mm-hmm. Where are you today on that issue?
Oh, there's no question in my mind that the allocation of Homeland Security funds shortchanges New York, and it shortchanges other places that are obvious symbols of America. You know, we were attacked, yes, because we're New York, but more because New York is a symbol of America's greatness, of our tolerance, of our diversity, of people utilizing the freedoms that we hold so dearly. And I believe very strongly that more of those funds should be allocated based on a threat-based analysis. And if that were the case, there would be more funds going to New York, more funds going to Washington, more funds going to places like LA. And I will continue to push and fight for that.
But this is a fellow governor of yours, a fellow Republican governor who is now president.
Well, he also has, there are two elements here. First of all, the president has been fighting and pushing to get more allocation of funds based on threat-based, where he would have more discretion. And I'm totally in agreement with him on that. Then Secretary Chertoff, when he did allocate the funds that with which he had discretion, and I, in my view, did not allocate them appropriately and should have provided more of those funds to places like New York.
You'll be governor for how many months?
Another 3.5 or 4, between 3.5.
What are you proudest of, and what do you regret the most about your tenure as governor?
You know, I think what I'm proudest of is not a particular area, or whether it's reducing crime or creating jobs and replacing dependency with opportunity. And we have almost 1 million acres of open space we've preserved. What I'm most proud of is that if you talked in this city today and asked someone what they think the future is going to bring, I think almost universally they would say, this city is getting better, this state is getting better, and that tomorrow is going to be better than today. And I remember 12 years ago when I was running, Charlie, I went all across the state and said, I have 4 children, and when they get through school, they'll be able to go anywhere in America, anywhere in the world. 12 years ago, they wouldn't have chosen New York. The hot spots were your home state, North Carolina, or the research triangle in Texas around Austin. People were leaving New York. On Long Island, I would hear time and again, our young people don't want to stay here. Well, now people from all over the country and all over the world want to be in New York. This is the exciting
place.
And why is
that?
I think because it's safe, because it's clean, because it is economically strong and getting stronger, and it is incredibly exciting. And part of the reason it's so exciting is because we do have people from all over the country and all over the world. And out of that diversity comes this incredible creativity that makes this not just one of the most exciting places, but I think one of the most exciting times to be a New Yorker.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Charlie. Good being on with you.
Governor George Pataki, back in a moment. Stay with us. Joining me now is Jill Abramson, managing editor of the New York Times. On Monday, September 11th, the Times will publish a special news section called Broken Ground. Also, the Times will run 2 pages of updates to the paper's Portraits of Grief, the daily series of features about more than 2,000 of the people who died in the attacks. I am pleased to have Jill back at this table to talk about 9/11 5 years later, because the New York Times won 7 Pulitzer Prizes for its wall-to-wall coverage of that tragedy. Thank you for coming.
Thank you so much for having me, Charlie.
Tell me, what is it you think is important for your paper to do? Because you are the paper of record, not just of the nation, but of this city.
What we need to do is really the same thing we did from the moment of the attacks, which is this has been a transcendent story for the New York Times for the past 5 years. In part, we are a global news organization, but we are a newspaper whose heart has always been and remains here in New York City. And what we've tried to do from the first day through this coming Monday is capture the story, its impact on people, with empathy, with thoroughness, with scrutiny, and Portraits of Grief, which was such a centerpiece of the section that we began running in September of 2001. Many, I think, of your viewers will remember it. It was called The Nation Challenged, and it ran as a standalone section with no advertising, thanks to the vision and commitment of Arthur Sulzberger, through the end of that year. And its signature feature was Portraits of Grief, which were portraits of the victims of the attacks. And really, rather than conventional obituaries, they became celebrations of their lives.
I think we have to remember that. I mean, I think you're absolutely right on target. I mean, we very much have to ask ourselves in journalism, what were the consequences of 9/11? And we have to look at all the things that have taken place, but we have to also not forget the Portraits of Grief, not forget, you know, all the bravery, the courage, but also the loss, and also the pain, and also how it changed people's lives in a moment.
In some ways, the original portraits were not full of grief. They were full of life, because they were about these amazing people, whether they were firefighters or brokers, many who were, you know, struck down at the pinnacle of vibrancy of their lives. And what we're doing Monday is looking at the toll of the 5 years, how people have coped with their loss. Its focus is really, these are true portraits of grief, because they're about the family members of the people lost and how they've adjusted. Some of the portraits are full of resiliency. There have been remarriages, there have been bursts of babies, there have been very touching ways that family members have remembered and memorialized their loved ones. And some of them are very, very sad. Some of them are, you know, horrible, wrenching stories of, you know, when bad things continue to happen to good people, where the loss of 9/11 has been followed by illness and whatnot. And we have about,
which is an emerging story.
We're going to present to our readers, beginning on page one, about 30 of these 5 year later portraits. And, you know, when you were saying, you know, it's important to remember the heart and the human impact of the story, I think people sometimes forget that journalists were impacted too, that yes, our job is to cast a critical eye, to hold the government accountable, but, you know, we have a very big stake in the safety of our nation too, and care very much about what was lost that day. I have colleagues who lost loved ones. I was Washington bureau chief on 9/11, and our house was right near the Pentagon, and my son could feel our house shake at the impact. I had neighbors who had terrible losses. My son was in high school at the time, and he was lollygagging and late for school. And then our job is also, as I said, to be full of scrutiny, to hold our government accountable. That's what the founders intended for journalists. And so I'll move on to Broken Ground, which is going to be a standalone section in Monday's paper. It's going to be 12 pages. It's a single piece of narrative investigative journalism written by Debbie Sontag, who's a wonderful correspondent who's covered the city, who's been a foreign correspondent. And what she's looking at is why 5 years after the attacks, Ground Zero is still a 16-acre, 17-feet deep hole in the heart of our city.
And what's the core of her argument?
The core of her argument is that there's been an epic clash of big money, prime real estate, and the people who control it, differing artistic visions, bottomless grief. Mm.
In terms of families feeling like they have they're a stakeholder in this.
And politicians with dreams of legacy in this. And yet, no one person who could cut through this logjam of intense feeling and clashing interests. You know, I think sometimes of Robert Caro's books about Lyndon Johnson. Or about Robert Moses.
Exactly,
I mean, this is the un-Robert Moses story that we're
really
telling.
Is. And when you were saying that, I thought, you know, sometimes there seems to be a time in human events when you need a czar.
Yeah.
When you need somebody.
You need someone with a little bit of ruthlessness and vision.
And who can meet them on their own ground and literally hammer them into saying, this is too important, too sacred to allow you to continue this kind of ego bickering. Everybody trying to protect their own turf, to achieve their own ends.
Right.
And it didn't happen.
And Debbie's take is not, you know, without understanding for all of these interests. It is a story, sadly, of good intentions that just didn't have follow-through, whether it's the governor and the state, you know, who controlled the site, or the architects, you know, who originally wanted a tower 1776 feet into the sky, or families who didn't want this hallowed ground built on.
Wanted nothing there except the.
It's a very sad story, but at the same time, it's full of wonderful characters. And Debbie spent months reporting it. She interviewed most of the people directly involved and has their voices throughout the piece. It's riveting.
Is there any sense that after 5 years, finally, they've turned the corner?
Well, I passed by Ground Zero today. I live very nearby. I live in Tribeca. I walk my dog by the site, and there's some construction. It's all still below ground level. And, of course, my newspaper today had on the front page the artist's renderings, which are very beautiful and dazzling, of the buildings that are supposedly to come.
By 2010 or 12.
But, you know, having read every word of Debbie's study, I'm just skeptical that the skyline that was portrayed in the artist's rendering is going to be reality anytime
because
soon.
All of the things that have prevented him so far still have residue.
Yeah, including, you know, there were security worries that made the original plans for the site, you know, had to be scrapped, whether it's the Freedom Tower
because
or the
New York
Memorial
Police Department
site.
Came in and said,
right,
this is not,
you know, too easy a target. One thing we know about the terrorists is their pattern is to return. Ground Zero attacked twice, so that makes it all very difficult.
Are you surprised at the number of people, and some of them you heard in conversations I've had at this table, who see the legacy of 9/11 as the Iraqi war and the division it has caused in the country?
I'm not surprised. I'm not sure that really is the full legacy, especially, again, returning to the portraits of grief and the story of the families 5 years out, or a few days ago we did, I thought, an amazingly compelling story on illegal immigrants who lost family members in 9/11, who did get settlement money, but who are really carrying on with their lives in a very brave way. I think we tend to forget about the strength and resiliency of this city and this country. Sure, the war has created great divisions in the country and global complications, but I don't think it's the whole picture.
I don't either. But the division is so deep.
Terrible.
Your newspaper won 7 Pulitzer Prizes.
It did.
Later, after that, went into turmoil over editorial changes that took place. And that's one story. that didn't so much have to do with 9/11, but had to do with a whole kind of internal issues at the New York Times. Has there been an impact beyond that, in terms of 9/11, and on the paper itself, on newspapers in any way? Did it change the Times, I guess, is in the way that we are talking at this time about how 9/11 impacted, what it made us believe in, what it made us lose faith in, what it scared us about, what it made us willing to accept in our lives?
I think it changed the paper in certain ways. It was always intensely committed to covering international news, but obviously with the war in Afghanistan, followed by Iraq, followed by terror attacks in Spain and London and elsewhere, that has become ever more so. And I think the commitment we've always had is ever more intense and so important during a period where not only other newspapers, but even television networks and others are, because of the great expense of maintaining an international staff, are actually cutting back somewhat on that. So, and it's actually intensified our international focus and commitment. I think it's changed the way we display photographs in the paper. Well, in part, the seven Pulitzers, which included two for photography, grew out of both our amazing staff of photographers, but also I have to say you referred to the turmoil. The editorial vision of Hal Raines, who was the executive editor during 9/11 until 2003, and he wanted to restore photojournalism to the core of the paper. And in that special section, A Nation Challenged, it was not unusual to have half page of one beautiful photographic image on the cover. And Bill Keller and I have tried to maintain that standard during our leadership of the paper.
One last question. Great editors ask great questions and have reporters go out and try to answer those questions. Or they listen to reporters with great questions and say, go find the answer. Tell me what the great questions are about 9/11.
The great questions about 9/11 are, number one, why there hasn't been another attack in this country. There is no simple answer to that. It's just a fact. There hasn't been. But we did a national poll that we published yesterday, which shows, especially here in New York, two-thirds of New Yorkers worry about another attack. A third of New Yorkers say they think about 9/11 every day. So there's a new normal, and I think a fundamental question will be what the new normal is and how that evolves. There hasn't been another attack, and yet in our country there's this extreme apprehension that there will inevitably be another attack here. Will there? I just think that's
an
elemental.
What will be the nature of it this time?
Yeah.
Are we talking about not so much
other,
will it be horrendous too? Will it be because of some use of weapons of mass destruction, whether they be chemical or biological?
You know, another huge question is the trade-off between security and protecting the country and what liberties we're willing to sacrifice, how we are viewed in the rest of the world. Will the view of the U.S. ever return to what it was immediately after 9/11? Can we recapture some of that? That's a huge question.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you so much for having me.
New York Times on Monday, extraordinary coverage of 9/11 on 9/11/06. Back in a moment, we'll turn to another New York story. It is the U.S. Open. Jim Courier joins us. Stay with us. The U.S. Open tennis finals are taking place on Saturday and Sunday in New York. The men's semifinals on Saturday, the women's finals on Saturday night, and the men's finals on Sunday afternoon. Joining me now to talk about this year's U.S. Open is Jim Courier. He was once ranked number one in the world and has four Grand Slam singles titles to his credit. It is an exciting U.S. Open, and I am pleased to have him back at this table.
Sure,
so here's my first question.
Okay.
All right, I watched the other night, was it last night, Federer and Blake?
Mm-hmm, last
in
night.
In your life, as good as you were, have you ever hit the ball as hard as they were hitting it?
I certainly tried, but I'll tell you, James Blake hit two consecutive forehand return of serves off big Roger Federer serves that I probably have never achieved. He absolutely was swinging from the hips, and that's what you have to do against Federer to have a chance, because Federer is so quick. His defensive skills are so good. He forces you to play closer to the line than anybody out there. Blake had to take his chances to even be in the match, and they both were taking healthy cuts at it.
Yeah. What's the future for James Blake?
Well, I think the future is now for James Blake. He's in phase two of his career. You know, he suffered from zoster,
right,
which is a neurological disorder. He was paralyzed, had half of his face. And he has now come back from that, breaking his neck and the loss of his right. father, and turned a corner. He's mature now. His game has really turned into something to be reckoned with. He's had the power that you talk about, he's had all along, but he now has the patience and the perspective to really make it work, because, you know, you can have all the shots, but if you don't know when to use them, it doesn't matter what you have. And he's now starting to have the ability to wait for the right time to be offensive. And I think there's a lot of upside for James Blake. He's a number one ranked American. It looks like he and Roddick are going to battle for that position, because Roddick may overtake him with this year's U.S. Open result. But James Blake is I think, after last night's match, has to feel even better about the way he's playing this year than even last year when he lost to Agassi in the quarterfinals.
Yeah, and almost said it's okay with me that I lost to Agassi
yes.
after the match.
Yes, well, he realizes that he was part of something very special last year, James Blake yeah. does with Andre Agassi. But he's also stated very clearly that he wants to win some matches that he's remembered for, not just be a part of great matches that he came in second. And that was what happened again last night.
We've done this before. Tell me what it is that makes Roger Federer probably the best tennis player ever to play the game.
Well, I think on his day, I think he's the best that's ever picked up a racket. I think he's the most complete tennis player, Charlie, and I think that's the thing that is separating him from the pack that he's playing with today, and eventually could get him the records that he's going to need to justify that he is the world's greatest player on the men's side. He doesn't have a weakness. His forehand is the biggest in tennis. His serve is unreadable. It's not as big as Roddick's, but it's every bit as effective because he spots it like a baseball pitcher. He just knows where to throw it. Mm. His backhand is elegant and effortless, and he has variety. He's a beautiful volleyer. As I mentioned earlier, he's a great defender of the court, and he's cool as a cucumber. And someone said this to me today. They said, you know, Federer looks like he's playing on ice skates out there.
He does. He glides.
He's just all even keeled and on the surface, and he's one of those special athletes that when you watch him move on the court, you know you're seeing something that you're probably not likely to see again.
And what's the story of the U.S. Open so far?
Well, the story for me is really, there are two parts to the story. First of all, we started with just pure emotion. Opening night, renaming the grounds for Billie Jean King for her pioneering ways. I think a perfect compliment to Arthur Ashe Stadium is the Billie Jean King National Tennis Center, because you've got two great tennis champions, but the reason their names are on the door has nothing to do with their tennis, or very little. It has to do everything to do with them pushing the boundaries for the human spirit.
Exactly.
And I think that's the right thing for the USTA to do. Instead of taking corporate dollars, they did the right thing, sent the right signal. And then Andre Agassi, certainly announcing his farewell at Wimbledon this year. The run-up to it, he didn't get to play a lot of tennis, Charlie, because his back, just frankly, the reason he left the game is because his back was ailing, and we saw it in full view at the U.S. Open this year. The emotion of his three matches at this tournament, I've never seen anything like it at a professional tournament. I mean, you get caught up in the moment sometimes, but having stepped back now 4 or 5 days from when Andre played on Sunday, his last match, that was as good as it gets as far as, that's a time capsule moment for tennis. Andre's speech after playing his final match of the U.S. Open, that will live on in tennis history forever. He said the right things in the right way, with the right manner, and everyone in the place was broken
up. It was a bit like Lou Gehrig. You remember that famous speech
Absolutely.
Lou Gehrig made?
Absolutely was. It was incredible. I still get chills thinking about it.
Where is his place in tennis history?
A lot of people are wondering where Andre Agassi fits as far as the greatest players of all time. And we don't think a lot about the players before the open era, the Bill Tildens, right, the Henri Lacoste. We don't. It's a different world now playing with the new racket. So let's look at the open era players. And I think, you know, Rod Laver, who straddled that gap, certainly Pete Sampras, you know, you've got these great champions with all these records. Andre Agassi won everything that there is to win. He won each major at least one
time.
Only
six people have done that.
In history.
In history. Have won all four.
That's correct. He won the Davis Cup three times. He won the Olympic gold medal. He's won every trophy that's worth having. It's nice to mention that his wife has done the same thing, too. That's not a bad thing in the family. But I think more so, Andre is transcended the game of tennis. And I think he proved it, especially underlined it this week, what he means to the game, with the grace and humility that he handled himself on his exit, because he's so tuned in with what's going on. He's a process guy, and he really did process everything that he was going through, and he had to split himself in two at this U.S. Open and be a between the lines, X and O, nuts and bolts, I got to win this tennis match guy, while at the same time taking the broader view, which I think is really a microcosmic view of how he looks at life. You know, I think he loves being in the moment, but he's also aware of what the moment means, and that's a hard line to straddle. So where does he fall? I think he's a top 10 all-time male player.
And perhaps the best return ever.
I think he is the best return ever. Him and Jimmy Connors, right. You know, you could argue that point. He's the best aggressive returner I've ever seen. And I think that because he transcended the game, I think you've got that amplifies his achievements for me.
Jimmy Connors is back.
Yes, he is.
As a coach
for
Roddick. Is he making a difference in Roddick's game?
An immense difference, and an immediate difference. They started working together after Wimbledon. Roddick went out to Santa Barbara, where Jimmy lives, and spent 3 or 4 days with him. And it was a trial, and they had a ball together. I think Jimmy was really enjoying, from what Andy said, the fact that he was getting back into the game and kind of reconnecting with the passion of tennis. And Andy was soaking up every last word and movement that Jimmy was bringing to the table. Andy Roddick is a new player. He is a better player, in my opinion, than when he won the U.S. Open a few years ago and reached number one in the world. He's playing a lot like Connors. He's attacking the serve.
He's a guy who's one of the great serves in the game.
He's got a great serve. But he's getting the returns going now, which is one of Connor's strong suits.
Yeah.
That was a liability for him. Now it's turning into somewhat of an asset. And he's also got a better court instinct. And how do you do that? You need to listen to someone who's been there, someone that you respect, and someone who's one of the greatest players we've ever seen, and also at the U.S. Open knows how to work the crowd. Andy Roddick's working the crowd.
So set up the men's semifinals, which is tomorrow.
Okay.
What should we watch for?
Well, I think that
first
of all, we've got two Russians in there, which is a first, and it's not Murat Safin who's won the U.S. Open. We've got Mikhail Yuzhny, a very talented Russian who's had some injury issues. He lost his father early in his life, recently actually, and that set him back. But he is playing some excellent tennis. He just took out the world's number two, Rafael Nadal, convincingly, and he's an aggressor. I think that he will struggle against Roddick's serve, and I think that Roddick is a heavy favorite in that match. The experience, I think, will be crucial for Roddick in this one, and also the swagger that Roddick's bringing, I think, will be too much for Yuzhny. Yuzhny may just be happy to be there, but he is a talent, and he bears watching.
He's a comer.
Yeah, no doubt.
Right. And the other?
On the other side, you have Nikolai Davidenko going up against the impossible. How do you beat Roger Federer in the semis of a slam? It's not been done in a while. Davidenko is a roadrunner. This is a guy who looks like he could go run two marathons back to back without breaking a sweat. He's not carrying any extra weight. He's like 150 pounds dripping wet.
Yeah.
But Tommy Haas played him and said it's like playing a ball machine. It's like that Roddick commercial with Pong.
Yeah, right.
But having said that, Federer has every shot in the book and he'll know how to use him. He's a heavy favorite as well. I expect a Federer and Roddick final.
And who do you expect to win?
I would expect Federer to win, quite frankly. You have to put all the chips on Roger, given what he's done. You have to have that much respect for his achievement.
But if there's a convergence of things, this might be it. With Andy, with the serve, with the Jimmy tutelage,
right,
on a roll, with feeling confident, if he can do it, he might be the one that can do it.
Well, I think he'd have to play a similar match to how James Blake played. And I think James was very close last night. He had some opportunities that he let slip by, but he was very much in the match because he waited for the right opportunity to strike without giving away unforced errors.
Did he come 1 point to tying it at 2-2?
He had set points in the first set. He had some other set points later, and he just didn't get returns in the court. He got a little tight. And Federer got tight at the end of the match as well, which is interesting. I think that has to give Roddick, you know, a little bit of an eye-opener that maybe if I can push this close, I'll get the crowd behind me, Roger may get tight, and I may have my chance.
The crowd, because it's America, will
yes.
be for Roddick.
Of course. And because Connors is sitting there. Come on.
Yeah.
That's huge.
Come on. Duh.
You're better than that, Charlie. Come on. You knew that.
Yes. Okay. Talk about the women. What's happening over there?
Well, I think the final is a very interesting one in prime time tomorrow night with Sharapova trying finally to get that second major. But she's been all around it. She's been in a lot of semifinals.
She won Wimbledon, what, 3 or 4 years ago?
A couple years ago.
Right.
And since then, she's been consistent, but she's not been able to push it over the line. And she needs to do that, I think, for her own sake.
Yeah. Does she have a coach? Is it still Nick Bellatieri, or was it ever Nick?
It was Nick. She grew up there.
Yeah.
And she's working primarily.
That's right. Her parents sort of shipped her over to Bradenton or wherever this place is.
Yeah, and her father moved with her there when she was about 7, 8 years old.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah, they've been there a long time, and now she spends most of her time in Los Angeles. Her father's primarily her coach.
Yeah. She has a huge endorsement game, doesn't she?
She's got a big portfolio.
Portfolio is the word we use.
She does. She's got a lot of endorsements.
I mean, we're talking $10, $15, $20 million a year.
That's what they say. And I would imagine you can't drive around New York City, as you know, and not see her on a billboard. She's very popular.
And who will she be playing?
Well, she's playing Justine Henin-Ardenne, who is in her fourth consecutive major final this season. She's joining select company in doing that. She won the French Open.
Right.
Amélie Mauresmo beat her in Australia and Wimbledon, right? So that's going to be a tough one because Justine provides, I think, the stiffest mental challenge in women's tennis. She's tough, and Maria is tough, and she wants it too. Maria's got to be careful not to want it too much. She's going to have to temper that excitement.
What happens if you want it too much?
Well,
if they all want it too much?
It's like if I'm in a bar and I go up and talk to a girl and I'm a little too excited and I kind of try and press the issue too fast, they kind of, back.
Yeah, I've seen you do that. Yeah.
No, you have not. That's not true. But trophies are like that.
Yes, I know.
If you try and grab a trophy too soon, it will not let you have it. It will
Is
have
that
a force field around it.
You have to what? Let it come to you or you have to be measured?
Like Andre would say, it's a process. You've got to enjoy the process of trying to figure out your opponent. You've got one person to beat, but you can't touch a trophy until you take that person out. So if Maria goes out there thinking about winning, she'll have lost. She has to go out there and think about executing her shots. That's the fine line.
Tennis has nothing like trash talk, does it?
Well, a little bit.
When does it take place? In the locker room?
Well,
when they pass each other?
A little bit. We've seen some when players pass each other in the past, absolutely.
Did anybody locker have a trash talk to you?
Oh, sure.
What would they say?
They
would say, Kirk, you don't have it. You don't have it today.
Well, there's a reverse psychology, which is also, God, you're serving well when you are, and then you start thinking about it.
And the idea is to make you think, and so you lose your rhythm.
That's one way to do it. Another one is just to start degrading and saying, this guy's lucky. He's never played this well before. This is ridiculous. He can't keep this up.
You say that to him?
It's been said to me. I would never say something like that.
You didn't do anything like that, did you?
Never, Charlie, please.
And what's the psychology in terms of playing a match? You want to intimidate. And how do you intimidate other than having the strokes that Roger Federer had?
Well, because tennis is like boxing, because what I do impacts you directly, intimidation and the way you carry yourself on the court is very much a part of it. This is a mental and physical battle. So if you have an even battle, certainly you want to control the tempo of the match. You want to take more time, go to the towel. If you're playing too quickly sometimes and losing, that's a bad thing. So it's an ego struggle to also to say, this is my court. You're playing in my house versus I'm following your lead. You know, you want to be the one leading the dance, not following.
And you do that how?
Controlling the tempo of the play, slowing play down, looking at your strings, taking time, going to the corner and getting your towel.
Now, who was best at it? Was this something McEnroe was good at?
Connors is phenomenal at it. He worked that towel like nobody's business. Yeah. McEnroe used, he would use his temper as a way to upset his opponents. I mean, he would actually use it to fire himself up. He still does, by the way.
Yeah.
And get
he still
the other
does, meaning what?
Well, he's playing on the Champions Series. He comes out and plays in our tournament.
He still screams and hollers?
Oh, yeah. Nothing's changed with John. He's still
Is that right?
He's as competitive as he was when he was 10 years old, I'm sure. Oh, yeah.
What are his skills as a broadcaster?
I think, first of all, candor. And John, I think one thing that John's really great at, too, is taking you inside the mind of the player. And he's unpredictable. And he's an interesting listener. I think that's when people talk to me about John and they ask, well, when you work with John, you know, do you like it? Do you hate it? What do you think? I said, I really love working with John because I never know where he's going or coming from. I agree with most of what he says, but he's always, you know, his mind works in a different way, and it's an interesting listen, and he's a terrific broadcaster.
When you, a viewer, what is it that a viewer misses that most of the tennis players see?
Well, I think the geometry of the tennis court is unknown.
Explain that.
Well, when tennis players play, it like chess, you play 1 to 2 to 3 shots ahead. So if we're playing, Charlie, and this is the court.
And if I go to your forehand across court.
Then I understand the geometry. If I hit it down the line, I have to start moving to this position. So I'm already thinking about my move to the next shot and what the impact of my shot is going to be on you. If it's going to draw a short reply, I'm moving at an angle forward. And like a hockey goalie, tennis players are covering the angle to give themselves the position to be in the center of where the ball is most likely to go. Does that make any sense?
Yes, of course.
Okay.
I mean, that's a famous quote that I don't play where the puck is, I play where the puck's going
to
be.
Right. Right. Well, tennis players have to do that, and the game has become so ballistic with the technology these days that you have to be even quicker, and you have to be able to react and adjust, and it's not patty cake. It's ready, fire, aim a lot of the time out there.
Serves are being hit at, what, 140 miles an hour at the best?
Andy's hit at a 145 so far this tournament. Yeah, that's pretty big.
Do you miss it a lot?
Well, I love it. I'm still here.
I know you. You know, but I get to not being out there.
I go play on the Champions Tour, so I play 5-6 tournaments a year.
Is that as satisfying and as challenging?
Well, for me, it is right now because I own my tennis right now. You know, when you're playing on tour, the reason it's a young man's game and a young woman's game is because it's 24/7. It's every day of the year. You're the team, and it's only really when you pull back from it that you realize how much tension and pressure that you face. Listen, it's great. I don't regret anything. I love the life that I've lived. I'm glad that I went through the process of becoming the best tennis player I could be and have been able to live this amazing life. But I don't know if where I am right now in my mind, I couldn't go back to that place at 17 and do that again. And Agassi,
what does it require?
Well, Agassi said the same thing. He says, listen, I couldn't go back to 17 and start this thing over again. I'm glad I did it, but I've done it. And, you know, there are other challenges that I want out of my life. And I think for me right now, the balance is I've got this business, so I'm able to kind of test myself and compete in one level of running tennis events and engaging in the business world with a lot of really interesting, intelligent people. And I still have the other side where I get to go out and compete one-on-one selectively. So the point of where I still go out and I practice and I love it and I try and play as well as I can. I don't have as much time to commit to it. I can't play 5 sets. You know, 3 days in a row like I used to, but I don't have to, and that's kind of the balance.
Who's the best player on that older tour?
Well, there are a few guys. I'm playing pretty well.
Yeah.
Todd Martin is playing pretty well. Yeah. So is Goran Ivanisevic. And Johnny Mack at 47 is amazing.
Because he has the touch.
He's got touch
and
anticipation.
Yeah.
Yeah, the court sense anticipation that he has, his style, he's the best 47-year-old male tennis player I'm sure that's ever played, because he works harder now. I promise you, Charlie.
He looks like he's in shape.
He's in better shape now than he was in when he was 25. I'm sure cardio-wise, because he works harder at it.
You'll be there. Thank you so much.
I hope you'll
pleasure.
Be there.
I hope so. I mean, if you're out there. No, I'd love to be out there. I mean, I'd just love to see. The way I'd like to see most of all is a Federer-Roddy.
Yeah, I think we'll get that.
Thank you for coming, as always.
Always.
Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
For every drop of yourself you give, get every drop back. We offer over 80 ways to hydrate, energize, nourish, relax, or enjoy every drop of life.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by JPMorgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.